Let's shift focus back to Ernest himself. He moved to the US, and as Jumana was saying, he started working with the African with the African American community, with the gay community there.
You listen to photographers talking about him, like for instance David Goldblatt. They describe his work as very intimate. He was he was one of the people he photographed. He knew their lives. He knew their the burden they had to carry. He knew what was going on.
So when someone told me the other day that pictures are objective, well, that's bullshit. I mean, they can't be objective, you know? There's a storyteller behind it who's actually putting their own view, their own eye, and on it to it.
And Gina Kirori from Kenya, investigative journalism. You could have chosen a much less dangerous job, I guess. Why?
There's something that I cannot keep quiet when I see a wrongdoing being done. So I think it really, bottom line, it's passion.
You cannot de-acknowledge the fact that we are all connected.
Being part of this conversation is not a question of being grateful for being here. I mean, we built this place.
He heeft het over een revolutie zonder revolutionair.
Je kan over revolutie heb je allemaal zo'n beeld van dan is er een grote confrontatie, die komt ineens en dan komt er iets nieuws. Terwijl ik het idee heb dat in Iran al heel veel jaren er een soort revolutie in het gevoel heeft plaatsgevonden.
Maar de bevolking is geëmancipeerder, is intellectueler, is hoog opgeleid. Ze willen het niet, ze weten het. Misschien is het ook wat groot in hoe het beleven is. Ja. Maar het is geen strijd tegen God, het gaat er wel tegen het regime.
En waarom verdient Winnie deze ode?
Winnie heeft gezegd dat Zuid-Afrika een socialistische staat moest worden. En dat de resources naar zwarte mensen moesten gaan. Want anders, als dat niet zou gebeuren, dan zouden we dus in de shit komen waar ze nu in zitten.
Speech about Nelson Mandela. But before I'm going to start with the speech, I would like to say I was very touched by the program before this opening. I attended about a program about Winnie Mandela. Good afternoon, everyone. Almost a year ago, the last Nelson Mandela lecture took place here in this theater. It was a wonderful gathering with poetry, with art, and thought-provoking lectures. I've been looking forward for this day for some time now, because today it is my great honor to open the fourth edition of the Nelson Mandela Lecture, organized by the ZAM Foundation. And before we officially start with our first speaker, I would like to take this opportunity to say a few words. Because a couple of days ago, I started preparing my thoughts for today, trying to create order in many impressions, thoughts, and also memories connecting to Mandela's legacy. This year, we mark that it has been already 10 years since Mandela passed away. And I wondered, what stories have we changed in the last 10 years? I thought about the words of Yvonne Adjambo Ovor. She said, "Can we imagine a world beyond inequality, hate, and oppression?" And for a moment, I could not imagine that world. Because even in my own city, we do not have to look far in order to see blinding hate, ignorance, and evil. And it left me feeling deeply, deeply sad. Then I thought about the reason we are here today, about Mandela's legacy. And I suppose in one form or the other, we all have some personal, heartfelt connection with the man and his work, and also his long walk to freedom. We all pick and choose from his rich legacy in order to be inspired. And then I felt what was most resounded in my heart, and that is, challenge the norm. Because when we challenge the norm, we also challenge the narrative. What was accepted becomes debated. We start to see movement. We do see change, often slow and painful and filled with sacrifice. But at long last, we do see change. Mandela has shown us, and also at great personal cost, that change is possible. I concluded that even if change is slow and you feel sad, you can find inspiration and hope in the people that challenge the norm. Their dedication, their resilience, and also their determination to keep going on. And we are lucky. We are lucky enough to have a new generation of heroes challenging the status quo. People, and I'll just name a few, forget me if I don't name all of them. Perle Miange, who demonstrated against Black Pete and was attacked by racists. Maricela de Cuba, who lost her job because of her activism. Her address and contact information was shared on Twitter. Naomi Peter was violently arrested in a mass arrest during a demonstration of kick-out Zwarte Piet. Jerry Afriyie lost his job in 2015 again because of his activism and was beaten several times by the police during protests. Akwasi Owusu-Amsah has done so much to challenge the norm, but has also endured threats to himself and his family. The Dutch MP Kautar Buchelift, who has endured the most on and offline racism of any member of parliament. And of course, I won't forget
you, Jessica Abreu and Mitchell Sainz, you're also here. We all know what happened in The Hague, in the city of The Hague. Berlay. Maricela, Naomi, Jerry Akwasi, Jessica, Kautar, Mitchell, and all those other heroes all made sacrifices. They believe that when you believe in freedom and equality, you have to challenge the norm. So before we officially start our lectures today, let's take a moment to think of the next generation who will be challenging the norm again. When all of us are old and hopefully wise, and let's think of those who did before. We are standing on the shoulders of giants. What fruit can they find in a Nelson Mandela's rich legacy that will show them how to continue and to endure? I admire them and hope they will have the courage and the strength to continue their mission. Thank you.
Fought in the fire, my heart is tired. Home keeps on calling, and hope keeps on pulling me. Fought in the fire, my heart is tired. Home keeps on calling, and hope keeps on pulling me down. I can't move around. Hope keeps pulling me down. I can't move around. Hope keeps pulling me. Even right now, in the middle of this crowd, home cries get louder. Even when the sun is out, there is a dark cloud hanging over me.
Afraid of the wind because she speaks to me in a language I don't understand but feel. I'm afraid of the cockroach and the bugs, mosquitoes like my blood, the way they speak, fly and walk, they feel at home with me. As if they're saying, you belong to me, but I don't understand their speech. I'm afraid of the dark. The thunder, the storm, this burn inside of me that is in a language I don't speak. I am scared and I am mad. I want justice for the forgotten names and the unnamed. I wish I could scream. My tears floating in the air turn into rain that the elements speak. Hear the footsteps of the cockroach, the buzz of the mosquitoes. The serenity of the moth, the wind, the earth, the trees, they all speak a language I don't understand, but feel.
Forged in the fire, my heart is tired. Home keeps on calling, and hope keeps on pulling me down.
To the Alderman for the Arts and Culture for the City of Amsterdam, Touria Meliani, and to that terrific performance by Huda. Thank you. And Huda's performance is part of a performance by Sites of Memory. That's an organization who are, amongst many other things, telling the story of Amsterdam's role in slavery and its colonial histories.
And they'll be coming back later on today for other performances. Okay, so welcome everybody to the fourth edition of the Nelson Mandela Lecture. That was appalling. That was really, really, really bad. All right? The brave man would be turning in his grave if he heard that, okay? He'd be nodding his head, he'd be wagging his finger. Come on. This is not a somber occasion, okay? Yes, we're talking about very urgent, very serious things, but my goodness, we're also going to celebrate progress, all right? So I'll give you another chance. Hello, everybody. My name is Ikenna Aswike, and it's my pleasure to be your host today. And on behalf of ZAM and all the partners who made today possible, I'd like to wish you all a very warm welcome, in particular to Your Excellency, Mr. Vusi Madonsela, the ambassador from South Africa, and his delegation. So thank you for being here as well. Today is rather special because it does mark 10 years since the death of Nelson Mandela. And back in 2013, his life was celebrated right here in this very theatre. And that's what we intend to do, is keep celebrating the spirit of Nelson Mandela. Okay, let's move on with a short quote. Humanity thinks in story. We see in story. We live out the stories that come to that we come to believe are the world. Those are not my words, those are the words of last year's Nelson Mandela Lecture laureate, Yvonne Owuor. And they really evoke the spirit of ZAM. ZAM is a place where storytellers come together to speak truth to power. But as much as they evoke the words of ZAM, they also evoke and try and amplify the work, the spirit of Nelson Mandela himself. And everyone, all the other Nelson Mandelas, if you like, who continue to fight for freedom against injustice, whether it's in the streets, in the courts, or in the theatre. And talking about the theatre, it's a perfect bridge. I'm congratulating myself there, if you notice. Sorry. But that's a great bridge to introduce our next speaker, who is a man who kind of personifies the power of the arts and culture to connect, to fight injustice. In Johannesburg, he was the CEO of the Arts and Culture Trust. He was a tenor and director of the Gauteng Opera. And in 2022, last year, he was appointed the new director of the Prince Claus Fund. So please give a very warm round of applause to Marcus Tebogo Desando.
Making this theater a little bit like a star of some kind. Good evening, good afternoon, everybody. I would like to first start by thanking ZAM Magazine for inviting me to come here. It's a very daunting position to be, and also to be the first speaker of an event of this nature. But for me, what was particularly important was when I was asked if I would consider being one of the speakers, was how would I reflect on being a South African, reflect on the teachings and the presence of a man like Tata Madiba Nelson Mandela. And so instead of looking for a very academic view of what we could all be talking about, his lessons, but rather look within and do something that I've never done before in my life, which is really talk about myself. Never done it before, ever. But I thought I could really give you a little bit of an insight on a young man from South Africa who stands before you as a director of a global organization that is stationed within the Netherlands, like the Prins Claus Fund. I was born in a country that was defined by limitations. These limitations were ascribed in a number of different ways. The one limitation that was the most obvious was that as a black man, I had no agency of my own, which was entrenched
the system of apartheid. Apartheid became a word adopted by the whole world to mean segregation. But for us, living at the time, it meant more than just taking away our freedom. It meant that our lives were predetermined. Even though I experienced my day-to-day life as a normal young man, I was able to go to school, I had my social activities that were seemingly designed by elders or the authorities, authority figures that were in front of me. I was able to live a life that for me was no different from any other child in my surroundings. From the time I had realized of the, from the time I had realization of the world I lived in, as I got to experience the boundaries that set around me, these boundaries were not written down anywhere. They were passed down to me by my adults around me. From just a normal disciplining of a misbehaving child to a child that was adventurous or free-spirited and didn't see the world from the same confines of these rules. As broad as these rules and concepts were, I learned to entrench them into my own existence. There was already so much to navigate. I didn't know the level of my restrictions until I was in high school, where my teachers would start conversations of the reality of our country. However, kind of hidden these kind of conversations were. And this was prompted mostly by riots that were targeted to disrupt schools as a way to force apartheid government to recognize and unban all political parties. And this for me was around 1986 and beyond. Also, as a young man who loved to perform and had the talent for singing, apartheid didn't allow me to not just perform in an art form I discovered with equal opportunity, whether it was from acquiring knowledge or even from having a career. This meant that for a black person, I had to prove myself more than was required for my white counterparts, even with less advantages. Maybe I need to first let you know that growing up in my country as a young man, that I was aware that security restrictions I lived under. This was characterized mostly by an ever-presence of police. And those who know me, they know I fear dogs. And whenever I see a dog, and there's a lot of them in the Netherlands, I feel like running away. And South Africans will know that dogs were very much used as a weapon by the police, and it's still very much PTSD, I suppose. The design system had levels of authority that any child could quickly learn. You had the municipality police, who were mostly made up of people from your own community, so you could really recognize who they were, and their powers were very limited. Then you had the national police, who were very much feared, because they had the power to incarcerate a person for any infractions that they didn't fit. I remember clearly when I was around 10 years old, witnessing police brutality firsthand, seeing a number of adults and mostly middle-aged ladies with so much fear in their eyes, running away from a yellow police van. And when caught, they were shoved into the van, pleading and fighting to no avail. And I didn't understand what this was about. And I only discovered later that they might have been arrested because they didn't have their passports or that they didn't have the stamp in their passport that allowed them to be there. These incidences, and there were much more that I could never really cover in the time allotted to me, were my introduction to the lack of freedom of my people. The realization that I do not have the autonomy to just walk to the white suburb and buy a cake, whether it was a birthday or anything, as it dawned on me. As I turned 16, I needed the passbook, the very same one that I saw people running away, not having. I was not free to choose my movement because the passbook, or what we call today ID, represented being in the system. So you can easily be tracked. I began asking more questions around my reality as a black person, and I learned of the existence of a man called Nelson Mandela. You have to understand that until the late 80s, the person and the name was banned. So no one learned about black people's historical struggles in their school's curriculum, or heard it mentioned in their households. We didn't even know what he looked like. People were afraid of being revealed as sympathizers of the African National Congress or any of our freedom organizations, of which Mandela was one of the recognized leaders of, or terrorists, as they were branded at the time. Now, fast forward to when I was about to complete my matric year and the end of my high school career, the ANC was unbanned. Nelson Mandela was to be released. And as I mentioned, we really didn't know what he looked like. And before this, we had sneaked and contraband pictures of the man, and for most part, we didn't even know if they were really him or not. And it was really wonderful for us to see on the day that he was released that we could finally see the man himself. And as you can imagine, it was a moment of complete joy for us as people. With the country now released from the rule of apartheid, I still did not know how much agency I had in my life. But Mandela was now speaking to the world and all of us about our freedom and what that freedom means. Also because records were now at the time easily accessible or shared, so were the transcripts from his trials where he was recorded as saying one of the many quotes, he said, and I quote, "I do not believe, of course, that the government was in any way sincere in saying it was part of government policy to extend autonomy to Africans." Unquote. That word autonomy stuck to me. This gave me the courage to pursue my career as a singer and made it possible for me to rise within the ranks with very little fear of being discouraged or even denied. There's lots of stories about that, but that's for another day. Autonomy to me is not an intangible word. It is a state of mind beyond the definition on any dictionary. It means that I have the freedom to dream, imagine, decide, and live the life I see possible without having to ask for permission or even consider how I would be perceived. Autonomy means I can, as a black person, black man from a country that was so curtailed by a horrific system of oppression, pursue and live my true self. And for me, that is what Mr. Mandela kept reminding us of and continues to do so even today. So we can walk, talk, and feel that what we are and contribute to the world comes from a spirit that is always going to be flying high. We were now free to pursue whatever we wanted as a people, and that there were no restrictions on what our future could be. You have to know that for a man who was at first a myth to us growing up, and now to hear him directly and see him advocate for autonomy for us as people, and seeing him challenge oppression and win, his actions as a South African makes me celebrate all of who we are every day. So having moved to the Netherlands almost a year ago, I find that the lessons and words of our father, as we affectionately refer to him as Dada, a term from the language Xhosa, one of our languages in South Africa, are constantly affirmed, and in some instances, challenged, even for us. This translates in how interaction with my counterparts is and how I see myself within a community I have immigrated to, or sometimes inner struggles with myself on whether my actions need permission or not. I'm even more aware of why it is important to possess this concept that could seem to be taken for granted by the North and the West. Autonomy for me, this word, means I can be a South African in a foreign land and still seek to represent what shaped me. Accept that being different is not a sign of dissension, but of retaining one's identity and freedom just to be. I'm very grateful, not just for the teachings through example of such a man as Nelson Mandela, who even when you are fortunate enough to meet him, and I was one of those people that was fortunate enough to not just meet him, but also perform for him, so twice, I felt quite honored. instead of demanding reverence from you, he took the time to say always a few words. And I quote, this is what he said to me, I remember it very clearly. Now is the time that you own the world and that you are just as worthy. I'll never forget that. That even if you find yourself in another country, that you still feel that your connection with your past is what gives you the freedom to conquer the world. When I was asked to speak at this lecture, I wanted to share with you what Tata Madiba meant to me personally, and I hope that my story will enforce the belief that I know a number of you have, that he is a man that didn't just challenge a system of oppression and was willing to die for, but that he influenced us from South Africa to want to make the whole world a better place, and that his actions and those of his counterparts are bearing fruit. Even my work and contribution I bring to my current role as the director of the Prince Lars Fund, a company that believes in the power of culture and people, and that the people that gives life, that give their own lives to using it to contribute to a better world. At Prince Lars Fund, we do this continually advocating for unrestricted events, unrestricted investments to our beneficiaries, and we do not dictate to them how they need to use the grants that they receive from us, and are open to learn from them daily on how we can positively contribute to the world that we live in, and that we can afford them to be positive contributors to the work that they do. I would like to invite all of you as we leave here today to find a moment to celebrate your freedom and how you could be a part of a people that will seek to see anyone you can come across to also be affirmed that they have the power to be advocates for the power of a people's autonomy.
Good afternoon. My name is Ntjam Rosie, and I'm very honored to be here, to be part of the story. And if one word is important today, is reconciliation. And happened to be that I made a song called Reconciliation Song. That's what I will perform for you now. Forgive me for what I've done, my love. Please accept this apology. Let's reconcile.
Ntjam Rosie, everybody. Thank you very much. And Ntjam Rosie has reworked her seminal album, L, which will be coming out at the end of April. So do look out for that. And thank you, of course, to Marcus for sharing a very personal story about the power of autonomy and independence. And what a quote. Imagine Nelson Mandela saying something like that to you. Now is the time that you own the world. How empowering, but also the pressure. I don't own my own house, let alone the world. My goodness, really? Do you have to say that? No, that's beautiful. Wow, what a quote. Okay, time now to listen to our second fantastic speaker. A very impressive young woman. Born in Zimbabwe, she is living partly in South Africa and right now partly in the States, where she's studying for her PhD at Harvard University. Multiple award-winning, she's written books, innumerable articles in newspapers and magazines. She's a pundit. She makes me feel very inadequate. Please give it up for Panashe Chigumadzi.
You do not say sorry with your mouth. Our historical consciousness of African moral law demands that we ask the Dutch, the French, the British, the Portuguese, the Germans, and all our other enslavers and colonizers, "Nixolisa ngani?" With what are you apologizing? This is the core of our African restorative justice and jurisprudence. As Black people, we ask, "Utolisa ngani?" With what are you apologizing? Because it is understood, the material makes manifest the spirit of intent. Reparations infleshes the spirit of atonement in our modern, or rather our material world. "Nixolisa ngani?" is a question that demands that our enslavers and colonizers open their hands and show us the substance of their apologies. We must be clear. Reparations will require nothing less than the end of this world as we know it. To demand reparation is to demand remembrance. To repair is to remember. To remember is to know how we arrived here. It is to have a historical memory of the past, present, and the future. And so, let us begin at the beginning. Transatlantic slavery is the material and metaphysical womb of the modern world. Our former enslavers and colonizers know this all too well, and it is for this reason that they will refuse to open their hands and go beyond so-called regrets and apologies and give reparations. To give reparations is to end the world, to turn upside down everything that this 600-year-old modern world system is built upon. To demand reparation is to confront the terrifying reality that everything in our material and metaphysical worlds will have to change. Slavery is the womb of the modern world. No less a figure than Adam Smith, the father of modern capitalism, declared in The Wealth of Nations that the discovery of America in 1492 and that of a passage to the East Indies by the Cape of Good Hope in 1498 are the two greatest and most important events recorded in the history of mankind. In the 19th century, Marx and Engels repeated Smith's claim in the Communist Manifesto, declaring that these twin events, the discovery of the so-called New World and the rounding of the Cape of Good Hope, gave to navigation, commerce, and industry a monstrous impulse never before seen in the history of the world. And yet, what Smith, Marx, and Engels neglect to name is the ghost in the wondrous machine of modernity, the transatlantic slave trade. Slavery is a material womb of the modern world. At the very center of the new worlding that unworlded us as black peoples was the Dutch East India Company. Less than a decade after the first Dutch slave ships rounded the Cape of Good Hope, the VOC was founded in 1602, rather. This first multinational monstrosity was the first to link the East and the West and pioneered the global slave trade. In so doing, the VOC became the 17th century's richest and most powerful company. For most of the Dutch Golden Age, the VOC monopolized the transatlantic slave trade, providing the finance and technology that enabled their fellow English, French, Spanish, and Portuguese enslavers to establish their own slave-based empires. As the world's first multinational corporation, the accounting ledgers of the Dutch East India Company lay bare the fact that the term racial capitalism is in fact a tautology. Capitalism is always racializing. Racialization is always capitalizing. What is capitalism, after all, if not a system for sorting who is most fit for exploitation and extraction? Slavery is the metaphysical womb of the modern world. In 1637, the year the Dutch accelerated the global trade in African bodies by conquering the Portuguese slave markets of Amina Castle, Sao Tome, and Luanda, René Descartes, the central Dutch Golden Age intellectual and father of modern Western philosophy, pronounced its first principle. I think, therefore I am. Far from emerging in a historical vacuum, the Cartesian mind-body dualism was birthed alongside the rise of the transatlantic trade in African bodies. And so it constructed the precondition for reason and rationality in modern Western philosophy as bodilessness. From there on, Descartes' dictum, I think, therefore I am, constructed the reasoning and rational subject against the non-reasoning and irrational enslaved embodied black, who, according to the likes of Hegel, Kant, Hume, and even Nietzsche, was situated outside of history, moral law, and consciousness. Thus, reason and rationality were structured by anti-blackness from the very start. The White Fathers thus declared in oppositional terms, we think because the other does not. We are because the other is not. The master is because the slave is not. With the rise of the transatlantic trade, the European metaphysical world deemed all people of African descent as having no claims to bodily integrity, territory, or sovereignty, because we have no claims to reason, rationality, morality, and ontological legitimacy that the master is bound to respect. We see this in the Cape Dutch settlers' dismissal of the moral and political arguments put forth by conquered indigenous leaders in the aftermath of the 1659 Khoi-Dutch War, South Africa's first major war of resistance to slavery settler modernity. The Khoi leaders, several of whom, such as Nemoa, had traveled to other parts of the Dutch slave trading empire, objected to Dutch land conquest by invoking the indigenous claims to land and sovereignty based in African jurisprudence. They asked, and I quote, "If we Africans were to come to Holland, would we be permitted to act in a similar manner as you act here?" Close quote. The conquered Khoi leaders continued to try and reason with the settlers, demanding, open quote, "Who then, with the greatest degree of justice, can be required to give way? The natural owners or the foreign invader?" Close quote. Exacerbated by the insistence on their sovereignty, Jan van Riebeek, the Dutch East India Company official who established Cape Town as a refreshment station in 1652, responded that he was not bound to respect their laws and claims to territory because their land had been, in his words, won by the sword. Thus, claiming his European right of conquest, which had its genesis in the 1493 Papal Bull, which authorized the Spanish conquest of America, Van Riebeek deemed all indigenous land, no matter where it be, empty land for theirs to take. The moral law and reasoning of the masters thus superseded those of the enslaved and the colonized. This world cannot imagine itself outside of this master-slave dialectic. It is this dialectic that has propelled the history of modern struggle. In many ways, South African history, from Vasco da Gama's landing at the Cape of Good Hope in 1497 to apartheid's fall in 1994, frames the history of modern social and political struggles between slaver and enslaved, colonizer and colonized, capital and labor. Because of its historical and geopolitical constitution, among them its strategic location as the midpoint between East and West, its vast concentration of minerals, and its temperate climate, history's extremities have coalesced at Africa's southernmost end. It is no accident that South Africa is today's most unequal society. Born in the womb of Cape Dutch slavery, South Africa's history grew to embody more intensely than most the violent consequences of the benefits of a white settler minority linked to Europe and the misfortunes of a black indigenous majority linked to Africa. It is for this reason that Stuart Hall famously asserted, "South Africa is a world historic limit case in the theoretical sense and a test case in the political sense." And thus, apartheid South Africa staged the most compelling political drama of the 20th century. It's no surprise then that global whiteness held its breath in anticipation of a night of long knives for white South Africa on the eve of black majority rule. Instead, Mandela's South Africa gave a world at the end of history a miracle, a rainbow bending towards justice. Mandela's post-apartheid miracle seemingly absolved global whiteness of its sins. After 1994's negotiated settlement secured black political rights with the protection of white property rights, Mandela's post-apartheid government mandated the creation of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. South Africa would not go the Nuremberg way. South Africa would go to church. Presided over by a purple-robed Archbishop Desmond Tutu, the world held the post-apartheid Truth and Reconciliation Commission as the exemplar of overcoming history and achieving global racial reconciliation. As he presided over the TRC, Archbishop Tutu thrust Ubuntu, the African philosophy best understood through the concept umuntu ngumuntu ngabantu, a person is a person through other people, into the global imagination. Describing the rationale for amnesty at the TRC as rooted in ubuntu, Tutu said, African jurisprudence is restorative rather than retributive. Close quote. And yet, Tutu's theology of grace and forgiveness was grounded in what his former comrade and colleague, Reverend Alan Busack, later critiqued as a Christianized ubuntu. Tutu's TRC was given the limited two-year mandate to hear allegations of human rights abuses between the 1st of March 1990, the month of the Sharpeville massacre, to the 10th of May 1994, the date of Mandela's inauguration. This was a painfully inadequate 4 to 4 year time limit on the history or on injustice in a country where Dutch conquest of the Cape in 1652 is the genesis of centuries of genocide, slavery, indenture, and land dispossession. Cape Dutch slavery is the womb of 42 years of racial terror that nominally ended with the fall of apartheid. We cannot begin to address apartheid's master-slave relations, or master-servant relations rather, without addressing master-slave relations of the Cape. And yet, the TRC disregarded them. This is despite the fact that African jurisprudence declares, "Ijala aliboli," a crime does not rot. In other words, because ubuntu operates across time and space, a person is a person through those who have come before us, those who come with us, and those who come after us. There is no time limit for injured persons or their descendants to approach the court of law for justice, redress, and reparations. Ubuntu's demand for restorative justice therefore holds no statute of limitations. And yet, by limiting the period of redress to 44 years, the TRC denied the specific centrality and historicity of slavery in the formation of South African society. As early as 1958, on the 28th of March, the Amersfoort arrived with the first shipment of slaves to the Cape of Good Hope, 147 enslaved Angolan children. Almost 7 weeks later, the Hasselt arrived with 228 enslaved people from Dahomey. From 1652 until the British captured the Cape for the second time in 1805, the Dutch imported at least 63,000 souls from all over the Indian Ocean basin, from Africa's east coast right up until the Indonesian archipelago. Not included in this number is the number of indigenous Africans conquered and enslaved by the Freeburger commandos legally authorized to wage wars of conquest and conduct slave raids through the Imbugastal system. By disregarding these foundational terrors and circumscribing them to 44 years, the TRC was in fact not bound by African jurisprudence, but by a Christianized ubuntu, as Busack rightly asserted. Thus, without the right or without the mandate to write the historic conquest of land and its peoples, Tutu's impossible task as the head of the TRC was to wield a Christianized ubuntu to reconcile black and white South Africa into a single nation he called God's Rainbow People. Apartheid's victims wanted the truth. 1 million black viewers made the weekly TRC special report the highest rated public affairs broadcast at the time. Apartheid's beneficiaries refused to confront the truth. Few white South Africans watched TRC special report, and white radio listeners objected to TRC broadcasts and caused a rescheduling to a time after 8 p.m., open quote, when most of the farmers are not listening, close quote. Apartheid's architects refused to repent. Apartheid-era President P.W. Botha declared, open quote, "I only apologize for my sins before God," close quote. If white South Africa did not repent or make themselves humble, it was surprised by and grateful for the lack of so-called bitterness or vengeance shown toward them by black South Africans. Beyers Nodier, a Dutch reform minister who was one of the few Afrikaners to publicly oppose apartheid, declared, "In some incredible way, God has shown the seeds of a gracious attitude, of the spirit of Ubuntu, in the hearts and minds of the whole African community." Nodier's seeming awe at the seeming miraculousness of the transition revealed some of the ways in which even the most sincere, committed part of white South Africa has failed to reckon with what the radical ethical demands of Ubuntu requires of them to have meaningful reconciliation with us black people. As black people, we ask, Uxolisa ngani? With what are you apologizing? Because it is understood you do not say sorry with your mouth. The material makes manifest the spirit of intent. Reparations infleshes the spirit of atonement in our material world. Ubuntu holds that ukuhlawula, praying reparations for injuries caused to others, is indivisible from ukubuyisa, the restoration of injured relations. Ubuntu demands costly forgiveness. You cannot receive forgiveness without giving up something as an act of your contrition. So we ask again, with what are you apologizing? Reckoning with Ubuntu as the basis of African jurisprudence and restorative justice is to take seriously the centrality of Ikhlawulo Yokubuyisa, reparations for the restitution of relations. To be sure, the TRC recommended limited reparations to victims and families who testified. Later, Tutu called for wealth tax on all white South Africans. The post-apartheid government rejected or ignored both recommendations. White South Africa rejected Tutu's wealth tax. Likewise, they have rejected black people's calls for land restitution. Today, white South Africans, 9% of the population, hold 72% of the land, while we, black people, 79% of the population, hold 1%. Just as they have appropriated our land, white South Africa has appropriated Ubuntu as a no man's land and emptied it of its radical ethical demands for restoration through reparation. In a world where the terms of reason, rationality, moral law, consciousness, and history continue to be dictated by our former enslavers and colonizers, the black demand for reparation and restoration remains unreasonable and irrational and conflated with retribution and vengeance. In other words, the black demand for reparations remains unthinkable in this world. In the terms of this world, radical African restorative justice remains the law of the slaves, and we continue to be dictated by the law of the masters. In light of these unequal terms of engagement, we consider the Dutch Prime Minister's December 19th apology for the Netherlands' historic role in the slave trade. We ask the Dutch state, with what are you apologizing? The Dutch apology for slavery is a sorry one. The Dutch apology for slavery is a sorry of the mouth. Hands empty, except for the offer of a 200 million euro fund for museums and institutions to raise awareness about the legacy of slavery. we ask, what is 200 million euros for the centuries of economic, political, social, and spiritual crimes committed against our people? What is 200 million euros from the bloody purse of the beneficiaries of the Dutch slave trading golden age? What is 200 million euros in an economy worth more than 894 billion euros? To be sure, the mathematicians or the accountants here can help us, 200 million euros accounts for less than 0.02% of the Dutch GDP. This insulting offer for reflections does not even account for 1%, let alone 0.5% of the billions built on the blood of the enslaved. Again, we ask, Nitolisa Ngani, with what are you apologizing? We ask, what is the meaning of an apology forced down the throats of the descendants of the enslaved and the colonized? To start, the Dutch state ignored the request for the apology to be made by the Dutch king himself. That the Dutch prime minister then chose to make the apology on the 19th of December last year and disregard the request for the apology to be made on Kitsikoti, the 150th year anniversary of the abolition of the Dutch slavery on the 1st of July 2023 is a grave insult. To add salt to the wound, the Prime Minister did not seek the organized input and support of the Caribbean, nor did he acknowledge or seek the organized input of the many African countries who also suffered at their bloodied hands. Be it the West and Central African countries, such as Ghana and Angola, whose Atlantic coasts bear the scars of at least 10 Dutch slave forts. No Mozambique and Madagascar, whose kidnapped peoples were shipped all over the Indian Ocean basin. Nor South Africa, where the Dutch enslaved at least 63,000 people. We must view the unilateralism of the Dutch apology for slavery as a statement of intent. The former master will continue to dictate the terms of reconciliation to the former slave. Our former enslavers will discipline us into the regime of compulsory forgiveness and reconciliation without reparation. Without reparation, our enslavers will continue to inherit and benefit from their crime. We ask again, Nitolisa Ngani, with what are you apologizing? We must remember that this former enslaver's refusal to give us reparations is not unique. Our British Caribbean counterparts have repeatedly suffered the insult of regrets for slavery offered by the former Dutch Prime Minister or former British Prime Minister David Cameron and Prince William on visits to Jamaica and King Charles on a visit to Barbados. On his 2005 trip to Jamaica, Cameron delivered his infamous Let's Move On speech. In it, he announced that Britain would spend $38 million in foreign aid to build a prison in Jamaica. A prison, mind you, to be filled with deported Jamaicans who had committed crimes in Britain. Rightly, our Jamaican brothers and sisters did not disgrace our ancestors and roundly rejected the British insult. In 2010, French President Nicolas Sarkozy, infamous for his Hegelian remark that Africa has fallen off the map of history, offered an aid and debt cancellation package to Haiti. This was just 7 years after Haitian President Jean-Bertrand Aristide demanded that France pay Haiti over $21 billion, the then equivalent of the 90 million gold francs Haiti was forced to pay Paris after winning its freedom from enslavement. it is no mistake that Haiti, which staged the first successful slave rebellion, became the first and only nation to pay reparations to its former masters and their descendants for generations. No sooner had Aristide demanded reparations than France and the United States staged a coup against him. We must be clear. The black demand for reparations is impossible within the terms of this world order. In August 2020, Namibia officially rejected the paltry $12 million that Germany offered for executing the 20th century's first Holocaust during the 1904 to 1908 colonial war against the Nama and Ova Herero people. Namibia rejected the offer not only because the sum is insulting, but because post-Nazi Germany had refused to name the genocide of close to 100,000 people a genocide. Further, they refused to name the reparations reparations. Instead, they named them healing the wounds. By 2021, Namibian protest eventually compelled Germany to name it a genocide and offer an apology. However, Germany has still refused to offer reparations. Instead, it has offered financial aid of $1.34 billion. What does it tell us when post-Nazi Germany, the world's poster child for repentance and reparations for the Jewish Holocaust, cannot be compelled to pay reparations for its black Holocaust of Nama and Herero people? The ongoing refusal of post-Nazi Germany, the global exemplar for reparations, to pay reparations for its sins against black people, forces us to confront a more terrifying revelation about the modern world, race, reparations, and anti-blackness. As one German historian confessed, reparations payments to Namibia could set a precedent for Belgium and the Congo, France and Algeria, or Great Britain and the history of the slave trade. Descendants of the Herero and Nama know that too. Close quote. And so does South Africa, and so does the Netherlands, and so does the world. Again, we must be clear. Black reparations are impossible within the terms of this world order. If slavery is a material, metaphysical womb of the modern world, reparations will require nothing less than the world's end. Our former enslavers and colonizers know this all too well. Undoubtedly, if a reparation agreement were to be reached for crimes against black people in the mold of the 1952 agreement between Germany and Israel to compensate for the Holocaust, reparations would bankrupt and collapse the Western economy. We must therefore confront this terrifying fact. Reparations cannot be offered within the terms of this world. A serious call for reparations demands that we liberate ourselves from the fiction that our black radical traditions are at best derivative of Western historical consciousness, moral law, philosophy, political and epistemological systems, such as the telos of international bourgeois democratic revolution. When our ancestors waged wars of resistance, they waged them based on their historical consciousness of African and Afro-derived political and epistemological paradigms. When, for example, the African National Congress, which had been nonviolent for nearly 50 years, held a meeting in the aftermath of Sharpeville massacre, Nelson Mandela declared his position to the Communist Party leader by invoking Tswana political philosophy, which holds Sibadana Asiboke Kadiatla. The attacks of a wild beast cannot be averted with bare hands alone. Raised in the Royal Aba Temple household, Mandela understood that African political philosophy holds that the question of violence and nonviolence is not one of moral principle, but one of tactics. In that post-Sharpeville moment, Mandela's African historical consciousness saw him argue that, in his words, it was wrong and immoral to subject our people to armed attacks by the state without offering them some kind of alternative, close quote. Importantly, Mandela came of age or political age with the radical Africanist generation of Anton Lembede. This Africanist generation radicalized the ANC in the 50s through firebrand African nationalism, which took its inspiration from the history of nation building and resistance of African sovereigns like King Mushweshe and Shaka and Sekukuni in the 19th century. It is with this consciousness of African armed resistance that Mandela became the leader of the ANC's new military wing, Umkhonto weSizwe, the spear of the nation. Importantly, our ancestors did not wage wars of resistance to slavery and colonization as liberal subjects striving for emancipation into the political order of this world, that is, 21st century Western bourgeois. To believe otherwise is a betrayal of our ancestors. When, for example, the Asantes defeated their Dutch enslavers in Berbice, part of contemporary Guyana, in their grand 1763 uprising, they installed their political leader, Kofi, as the Asantehene of the first Afro-Caribbean kingdom. Freed from their masters, the Asantes came together with the formerly or with other formerly enslaved Africans, such as the Creoles, to embed African political and cultural institutions within their kingdom's new governance model. In other words, the historical consciousness of our Black radical traditions demands that the telos of our Black or our Black liberation struggle is not inclusion into this world order. Our ancestors did not die for a seat at the table. Rather, emerging from the underside of slaving capitalist modernity, Black radical traditions emanate from the thought that is unthinkable within the terms of a world birthed by transatlantic slavery. Therefore, in this 21st century moment of so-called apologies and acknowledgements, we must think the unthinkable and demand the impossible of this world. We therefore ask our enslavers again, with what are you apologizing? We ask this question of reparations with the full knowledge that the question is unreasonable, the answer unthinkable, and the act impossible in a world birthed by transatlantic slavery. The gift of our own historical memory and consciousness is a freedom from a teleology that dictates that this is the only world possible or even desirable. It gifts us with the understanding that the world that we have is not inevitable or permanent. It is historically contingent and constructed. Armed with ancestral memory, it is up to us to participate in history and to end this world. When we call for the end of the world, we must remember the question posed by Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe at the first meeting of the Pan-Africanist Congress of Azania in 1959. Asazi ukuthi iyozala ngomoni. We don't know what kind of creature will be birthed. Sobukwe asked this question in relation to the freedom of Africans at home and abroad. Once we are free, what creature will we become? We must ask this question now. Iyozala ngomoni. Once the world is free, what will we become? What our African historical imagination of the future does tell us is that the premise of the new world must be this. Fita hom utware mutu. Directly translated, let the cow pass, grab hold of the person. In other words, uphold people over property. This well-known Southern African political philosophy inspired resistance movements against Black economic and social subjugation, and inspired Sobukwe's African Socialist Manifesto. Based in Ubuntu's radical ethics of personhood, fita homo utshware mutu, let go of your cattle, uphold your people, asserts the primacy of a person as a social being and not merely an economic animal. Moreover, if capital, or cattle rather, Freudian slip, moreover, if cattle are the historic center of African material and metaphysical worlds, demand, let go of the world, uphold your people. Informed by this historical consciousness, saw our people demand the end of a world birthed by the pursuit of profit so monstrous that it turned African people into property. Today, we demand reparations with the full knowledge that it will be the end of Euro-American capitalist modernity. We know that reparations with transatlantic slavery and colonization will bankrupt the West and collapse its economies. To this we say, let go of your ill-gotten property. Let us uphold our people. We must love ourselves and our ancestors and our unborn enough to end this world. We must continue to demand the impossible of this world and ask, Nixolisa ngani, with what are you apologizing?
But this story is not about him. This story is about the Khoi Khoi and San peoples who first inhabited their land. It's about the people who were stolen by the VOC and taken to Cape Town. The mothers, fathers, and children
taken from Angola, Mauritius, Mozambique, Zanzibar, Malaysia, India, Thailand, Sri Lanka, and other Southeast Asian countries. They built the city we know today. Their labor created the roads. It's their hands that they toiled the soil and planted the farms and the trees. In the same way that the VOC stole people from their birthlands, they took from the land itself. The VOC took hundreds of plants and saplings and seeds from all over the world and brought them back to the Netherlands. The colonizers also took their own plants and seeds and trees and planted them in Cape Town. In the VOC's company's garden stands the saffron pear tree. It's over 350 years old. It is the oldest cultivated tree in Cape Town, planted by the Dutch. If you listen and feel the brown soil, if you press your head against the tree's trunk, or you lay on the grass and look up at the sky, you will hear it all. You will hear them all. They lie there in wait, waiting for you to listen.
So many bodies, so many bodies buried in time. Too many pirates, too many crimes. We give pain to love, yes, we rise above. So many bodies, so many bodies buried in time. Too many pirates, too many crimes. We give pain to love, yes, we rise above. You count time, we celebrate the birth of new stars in the night sky. Way before El Wazim got the third star in her belt. Remembering is reconstructing the foundations of my family that are baked into the clay of this land and present in this body. This body is not a box, built to be carried by someone who thinks it is empty. The space in between my heart and my soul is an endless gallery, filled with the art of my humanity. In harmony with the living, we make waves with our feet at Uriquafe. No more silence. Our voices in our tears, receiving the not knowing. The transparent is a comfort. Our bodies hold stories that want to be told. We are exactly where need be, collecting the elements of change. If your glory is connected to violence, do not repeat. Our voices, transparent in our tears, seeking transformation to set us free.
What have we found in these cities? Stories of resistance, of power, of agency, connected roots between the so-called West, South Africa, and the East. Communities of people from across the oceans inspiring each other to take back their land. We know the work is not yet done. There are still walls that need to be broken, no matter what side of the wall you are on. Our histories are more connected than we realize. What binds us together now is the vision of the future that is based on the connected histories of our past. What are we willing to do?
Hear them now, dear calling. Hear them now, dear calling us. Hear them now, dear calling. Hear them now, dear calling us. Hear them now, dear calling. Hear them now, dear calling us. Hear them now, dear calling. Hear them now, dear calling us. Hear them now, dear calling. Hear them now, dear calling us. Hear them now, dear calling. Hear them now, they're calling us. Hear them now.
Thank you, everyone. Beautiful performance, beautiful performance. And of course, thank you to Panashe earlier on. Good grief, my brain was working overtime. How impressive, tour de force, thought-provoking, eloquent sort of essay, I guess, on philosophy, on law, and the case for reparations. And I asked her backstage, I said, oh, wow, so is this what you're doing, your PhD at Harvard? And she's like, no, just side interest. Oh, my goodness. What a smart lady. Okay, thank you very much, Panashe. Right, it is time for the final speaker of this fourth ZAM Nelson Mandela lecture series. He is a poet, but most Dutch people will recognize him for his incredible committed anti-racism work and for teaching us forgotten histories, from the Netherlands colonial history. A very, very impressive young man, and he's here to tell us a story about leadership. He is doing his keynote in Dutch, by the way, but the English translation will be available on the website. So, yeah, good luck following it in Dutch, otherwise read it online in English. Please give a very warm round of applause to our final speaker of the day, Jerry Afriyie.
Kerkdienst tot nu toe. Lukt het? Vast wel. Mijn naam is Jerry Afriyie. Ik sta hier voor jullie mede dankzij mijn inzet voor de mensenrechtenorganisatie Nederland wordt beter. Voor zover ik en mijn ouders terug kunnen bladeren, heeft de doorwerking van slavernij, kolonialisme en plunderingen op zwarte lichamen en gemeenschappen een diepe indruk op mij achtergelaten. Het is dan ook niet wonderlijk dat ik mezelf en mijn gezin en meest dierbaren heb opgeofferd om een bijdrage te leveren aan de voortdurende strijd voor Black Liberation. Een kleine 13 jaar geleden werd ik in Amsterdam Belmen, op een steenworp afstand van mijn huis, benaderd door kunstenaar Raoul Balai, om samen met anderen het diepgewortelde racismeprobleem in Nederland bespreekbaar te maken. Wij lanceerden kort daarna de Zwarte Pieters racismecampagne. In beginsel werden we uitgelachen en vaak tot op het bot vernederd. Niet alleen door de witte gemeenschap, maar ook door mensen die op ons leken. We hebben geweld en uitsluiten van onze landgenoten moeten trotseren. Maar we bleven trouw aan de universele strijd voor rechtvaardigheid, zelfs wanneer onze intenties en leiderschap op de proef werden gesteld. Ik heb het hier over een beweging die met slechts 3 mensen is gestart. En in 2020 liepen we met duizenden mensen door de straten, steden en dorpen van Nederland. Met één boodschap. Zwarte levens doen het toe en we zullen niet langer kritiekloos toekijken wanneer onze waardigheid en bestaansrecht bedreigd worden. Beste mooie mensen, beste organisatie, bedankt voor de uitnodiging om mijn gedachtenspinsels met jullie te delen. Er is zoveel dat ik met jullie wilde delen toen ik de uitnodiging voor me zag. Nelson Mandela roept veel emoties op bij mensen van verschillende leeftijden, met verschillende overtuigingen en achtergronden. Zijn opofferingsgezindheid spreekt voor zich. Hij wordt over de hele wereld daarom geroemd, omarmd en bovenmenselijke eigenschappen toegekend. Er zijn talloze citaten, boeken en fabels aan hem toegekend. Als iemand larger dan lijf is gemaakt, is het Mandela wel. Echter heb ik mijn enthousiasme kunnen matigen en zal ik mij vandaag richten op het leiderschap en de erfenis van Nelson Mandela. Niet om de levendige discussie over zijn nalatenschap plat te slaan of om de lovende woorden van presidenten, ambassadeurs en mensenrechtenorganisaties te herhalen. Ik hoop met mijn ervaringen en gedachten over leiderschap een bijdrage te leveren aan de discussie over de nalatenschap van een van de bekendste vrijheidsstrijders die de moderne wereld heeft gekend. Vandaag draag ik mijn betoog voor op de plek waar Mandela ruim 30 jaar geleden in Amsterdam toesprak, kort na zijn vrijlaten vanuit de Victor Vester prison. Mijn land houdt zielsveel van deze visionaire leider. Maar als ik s'avonds de paperback van Long Walk to Freedom wegleg en mijn nachtlamp uitzet, raast een brandende vraag door mijn samengetrokken lijf. Hielden we van Mandela omdat hij zo ver van ons afstond of omdat iemand anders hem en de zijnen pijn deed? Houden wij van hem omdat wij onze handen in onschuld hebben gewassen en het bloed van slavernij en kolonialisme, wat de weg plaveide voor apartheid, aan onze diversiteitdeken hebben afgeveegd? Wat als hij een zwarte Nederlander was geweest in nazaat en sprak over de pijn die wij hem en zijn volk aandeden? Hadden wij hem dan ook zo in liefdevolle brasa gegeven en omarmd? Hadden we hem dan ook op een voetstuk geplaatst en geciteerd als liederen uit een heilig boek? Na 3/4 deel van mijn leven in het Westen te hebben vertoefd, is mij één ding duidelijk. Wanneer zwarte mensen dood of ongevaarlijk zijn, worden we helden. Achteraf helden. Losgekoppeld van onze voortdurende strijd en idealen. Ooit zei ik, als Mandela hier in Nederland was geboren of had gewoond, hij vast en zeker zwarte Piet zou zijn genoemd. Dan zou hij alledaagse minachtingen en schofferingen zoals heel zwarte, rot op naar je eigen land of kankerneger moeten traceren. Madiba, zoals witte mensen hem liefkozend noemen, zou net zoals Aminata Cairo, Gloria Wekker, Klakakor, Amma Sante, Reetje Mamatine, Jeffrey Korndijk, Enid Birgitte, Andrew Makenga en Nawal Mustafa een verhaal paraat hebben over de zwarte realiteit die doordrenkt is met neocolonialisme, racisme, alledaagse discriminatie en witte onschuld. Jullie zien, Nelson Mandela kan net als witte Jezus in de ogen van witte landgenoten niets fout doen. En dat is niet alleen omdat hij tot zijn laatste adem ageerde tegen een fout systeem. Ook is het niet omdat hij zich schuldig maakte aan ruim 190 gevallen van verzetspleging tegen het apartheidsregime. Van alle strijders uit zijn tijd steekt hij met kop en schouders bovenuit. Een zee van witte obsessie die we niet zien bij zijn kameraden en medestrijders Steve Biko, Winnie Mandela en Robert Sobukwe. Mandela is vooral geliefd bij witte mensen omdat wat witte mensen ook met hem deden en wat zijn volk ook moest ondergaan, hij ervoor koos om een natie op te richten met de vijand. Ondanks dat hij de geschiedenis en God aan zijn kant had om bij enemy zijn volk te bevrijden van terrorisme en witte suprematie, hij witte mensen de hand toereikte. Hij sloeg geweld af en zette zich in om de pyromaan en het slachtoffer van de brand in hetzelfde huis te houden. En wat mij altijd zal bijblijven, is dat hij dit allemaal deed zonder een grijntje verlies van menselijkheid en zonder verlies van waardigheid. Mandela gaf zijn alles, waar hij bijna niets voor terugkreeg, en witte mensen roemen hem daarvoor. In de eerste plaats omdat witte mensen andersom zelf nooit, maar dan ook nooit, zouden rusten totdat hun leed elke zwarte persoon betaald was gezet. Voorbeelden zijn overbodig, bewijzen evenzeer. Net als veel zwarte mensen heb ik lang gedacht, wat doet hij nou? Lang dacht ik, iemand moet boeten voor wat onze broeders en zusters, kinderen en moeders en vaders in Zuid-Afrika is aangedaan. Lang koesterde ik de dag dat de moordenaars van Stibiko hun verdiende straffen zouden krijgen. En aan de galg met uitpuilende ogen. Iemand moest boeten. En ik had net als veel zwarte Zuid-Afrikanen destijds en nu barbaarse straffen voor ogen voor de daders. Voor de moordenaars van onze liefdadige Soweto-kinderen die van hun moeders borsten werden afgeschoten en hun vaders armen werden begraven. Maar niet Mandela. Hij die op de bergtop de toekomst voor ons vertaalde. Mijn leider had iets anders in gedachten. Een ander strafmaat. Een strafmaat die bijna niemand buiten hem om zag als straf. Er kwam geen wraak oefenen waarop de vele weduwen en ouderloze nakomelingen vurig hadden gehoopt. In plaats daarvan kwam een appel voor medemenselijkheid. Medemenselijkheid waarvan het de witte mens nog niet was gelukt om te ontwikkelen sinds haar komst in Zuid-Afrika. En die de Zuid-Afrikanen de onderdrukte voor de witte medemens de onderdrukking verloor in het proces van geweld. En daartussenin hield de leider Nelson Mandela zich schuil. Om niet alleen zijn volk, maar om ons allen de weg te wijzen, zoals je van een leider verwacht. Met een levende discussie als gevolg, die tot op de dag van vandaag en op dit ogenblik gevoerd wordt. Een discussie die je als volgt samen kunt vatten. Heeft onze leider genoeg gedaan, of had hij het misschien bij het verkeerde eind? Dit is een universele vraag en deze kun je toepassen op alle grote leiders die ons volgingen. Maar op niemand meer dan op Kwame Nkrumah. Ghana werd onder leiding van Nkrumah in 1957 voor het eerste land dat onafhankelijk werd van de Europese kolonialisme. Ik liet afgelopen vrijdag mijn haar knippen voor deze gelegenheid, toen terloops de nalatenschap van Nkrumah ter sprake kwam. Mijn kapper en twee anderen, alle drie met Ghanese wortels, vonden Nkrumah de slechtste leider ooit. Dit omdat hij 1. Te vroeg de onafhankelijkheid had ingeleid. 2. Omdat hij voor andere landen ging zorgen met het geld dat in het laatst zat na Ghana's onafhankelijkheid. In werkelijkheid ondersteunde hij met het geld de verdere onafhankelijkheidsstrijd in Afrika en omdat in zijn eigen woorden: "The independence of Ghana is meaningless unless it is linked up with the total liberation of the African continent." Je zou kunnen denken, hierop valt niet af te denken. Men zijn mensen zoals mijn getalenteerde kapper die hier heel anders over denken. En toch sta ik hier vandaag voor jullie om een pleidooi te houden voor het leiderschap en de erfenis van Nelson Mandela. In plaats van de nalatenschap van Kwame Nkrumah, die naar mijn mening het verste vooruit zag. En hierom. Nelson Mandela was een mens van matigheid, terwijl Nkrumah zijn honger naar meer macht onmogelijk kon stillen. Mandela is de eerste en enige Afrikaanse president die vrijwillig voor het einde van zijn termijn afstand nam van zijn troon en macht. Niet door een verkiezing, niet door schandaal, niet met geweld of door een gesponsorde Europese coup. Meer dan zijn opoffering, zelfdiscipline en charme heeft dit het meeste indruk op mij gemaakt. Dit nieuwe leiderschap is door geen van zijn leeftijdsgenoten geëvenaard. En ook niet door BBC's Man of the Millennium Kwame Nkrumah, of zij die na hem de troon bestegen. Ik zie mezelf niet als leider. Maar ik kan er niet omheen dat veel mensen in dit land dat wel in mij zien. Zie hier, daar heb je het eerste conflict aan. Hoe mensen jou zien versus hoe jij zelf ziet, kan het verschil maken in wat je ziet als jouw verantwoordelijkheid. En zodoende wat jouw bijdrage zou moeten zijn. Myself as legacy betekent, myself niet als legacy, betekent niet dat ik mezelf niet waardig vind. Ik vermijd zulke labels met krem. Simpelweg omdat ik erachter ben gekomen dat wanneer je een label op jezelf plakt, je jezelf erna gaat gedragen. Je gaat dan van een natuurlijk persoon naar een karikaturale schets. In plaats van dat je jezelf afvraagt wat je wil doen, ga je je afvragen wat een activist moet doen. In het proces vergeet je jezelf. Wie je bent en als gevolg waarvoor je het doet. En vanuitgaande dat Mandela meer dan een activist was, een mens, een vader en een opa, die zijn volk en land hield, die van zijn volk en land hield, voorzien kan ruis in verwachtingen, toen en nu. Mandela is geliefd, maar wordt ook terecht onder een vergrootglas geplaatst. Het zou een hoofdzonde zijn als we onze leiders niet kritisch volgen, bevragen en waar nodig bijsturen of verwijderen. Wij moeten ook eerlijk zijn naar onszelf toe, over wie onze leiders zijn, in welke wereld zij zich bevinden en hoe zij naar de wereld kijken. En aanvullend over welke middelen en menskracht om de vijand te verslaan zij beschikken. Je kan een gewoon mens niet verheven tot een soort God, met als gevolg dat degene aan de ene kant onevenaarbaar wordt en aan de andere kant in teleurstelling van hun God. Mandela moest witte mensen betaald zetten voor de apartheid en hij kon in de ogen van sommige activisten niet ver genoeg gaan. Kan het zijn dat zijn publiek liever een karikatuur van hem hadden gezien en niet de Mandela die hij werkelijk was? Velen ter illustratie liepen ook bij Malcolm X weg omdat hij niet langer in het wild riep dat witte medemens de duivel was. Kan het zijn dat hij het niet verkeerd had, maar dat wij iets verkeerds van hem vroegen? Verwachten wij echt dat Mandela eigenhandig in één mensenleven alles wat apartheid had vertrapt en veelal onherstelbaar kapot had gemaakt, recht kon zetten? Met welk leger, menskracht en middelen moest hij alle witte bezetters dubbel betaald zetten voor hun misdaden en of profijt aan die misdaden? De beste man was een advocaat, kende mensenrechten verdragen. Hij heeft vastgelezen over groepsuitroeien. Kan het zijn dat hij daarom alles op alles heeft gezet om de weg naar groepsuitroeien van zijn volk te stoppen en die van witte mensen te voorkomen? Hij was een belezen man. Kan het zijn dat hij de teksten tegenkwam die hem veel overtuigender waren dan de menselijke emoties en tradities? Dat hij nieuwe inzichten opdeed die tot op de dag van vandaag menigen van zijn medestanders en tegenstanders nog niet onder ogen hebben gekregen. A man who views the world the same at 50 as he did at 20 has wasted 30 years of his life, zei Waile Mohammed Ali. Een kwart eeuw geleden stevende ik af op jong volwassen. Ik wist het allemaal beter. En begreep de wereld beter dan mijn ouders, hun ouders en alle ouders ervoor. Ondanks dat ik net pas kwam aanmeren, was ik ervan verzekerd dat ik een 100% accurate voorstelling kon maken van situaties waarin ik mezelf nog nooit had bevonden. Hoe verleidelijk het ook is en hoe zeer mijn hart slaat voor wraak voor het voorbije, ik denk dat ik Mandela pas kan veroordelen als ik hetzelfde pad heb bewandeld en zijn levenservaringen en kennis heb opgedaan. Ook al was het apartheidsregime niet van eeuwigheid beschoren, er was nog altijd springleven in de jaren 80. En nog erger suicide vanwege de aanhoudende strijdlust van de zwarte Zuid-Afrikanen en de toenemende internationale druk. Een kat in het nauw gedreven maakt rare sprongen. Als leiders je in visie en overzicht toevertrouwt, de wind bereikt jou voordat deze land de rest waait. Je moet besluitvaardig zijn. Niet vanuit de onderbuik alleen, maar met name vanuit hart en geest handelen. Dat kan levens kosten of sparen. Als ik aan grote leiders zoals Mandela denk, heb ik geen enkel twijfel dat geconfronteerd met het kwaad, zij het meest haalbare behaald hebben. Met de beperkte middelen en mensen die beschikbaar waren. Vanuit de bestaande inzichten en de kortademige ruimte waar zij over beschikten. Met de kennis van toen hebben zij bergen moeten verzetten om wat wij nu wegwijven, kleine veranderingen doen, voor elkaar te krijgen. Ik denk dat de Mandela's, de Kwame Nkrumah's, de Amilcar Cabral's, de Jomo Kenyatta's en Obama's de eerste zullen zijn om toe te geven dat het werk, hun werk, nog onaf is. dat we nog niet zijn, dat witte suprematie nog altijd bezit heeft genomen van onze grond, lijf en geest. Neem het van mij aan. Het duurt altijd veel langer om iets recht te zetten dan om het kapot te maken. Net als jij en ik was Nelson Mandela geen god, maar een mens van vlees en bloed. Hij stond vrijwillig en met plichtsbesef in dienst van de mensheid en net als jij en ik was hij verre van perfect. Zijn bijdrage zijn echter een lichtpunt in de ruim 2 millennia duisternis waarin zwarte mensen sinds de Arabische slavernij verkeren. Hij heeft een poging gedaan en in het proces iets voor elkaar gekregen waarvan miljoenen zwarte en witte mensen dachten dat het onmogelijk was. Niet voor elkaar te krijgen was. Hij heeft ons een duw in de goede richting gegeven. Naar de uitgang, naar het licht toe. Zulke kleine winsten moeten als motivatie en inspiratie dienen om de volgende stap te zetten. Door zij die in de stadblokken staan. Zo geven we het stokje door. En als je dit in de hand geworpen krijgt, heb je geen tijd te verliezen. Dan moet je niet omkijken en vinger wijzen, maar voorwaarts blijven strijden. Het is een marathon en je stopt niet, nooit meer, totdat wij er zijn. Dank je wel.
Thank you.
these folks can do. Their new performance, Unbreakable, which is a collaboration with Lloyd Marengo and Jonesy D, will be performing, will be premiering, I should say, at the end of April in London, I believe. So head over there if you want to see even more of them. Folks, that brings us to the end of the Nelson Mandela lecture series. Wow, I mean, what can I say about Jerry's speech as well? It was phenomenal. You'll be very pleased to hear that after we're done in this room, there is a kind of talk after the talk in the Koninklijke foyer where all of our speakers will be available. So I'd like to, just before we all leave this room, invite Panashe and Marcus to come on stage, and Jerry as well. One final round of applause, please. That sums it all up, face forward. That is the theme of ZAM Magazine and this event and Stories for Change. So thank you very much, all three of you. And join us, please, for a beer and a chat and a tea and whatever you want to drink afterwards. Thank you very much.
Intens was.
Ja, even de story. Ja.